York City, where even the garbage is up against the wall. A nine-day sanitation strike dramatizes the plight and the blight of urban living. Health, not wealth, becomes a national obsession.
Well, in a way, it don't affect me except for the very bad smell here. It's terrific.
Starting to affect my business where customers can't get in here because of the garbage situation.
That's a disgrace. That's a disgrace. Where New York is really a disgrace.
Backlash against the environmental nightmare takes strange shapes and forms. Jogging's the latest. They do it in the road and in the parks. It's more fun than dieting. Healthy, stay alive. In South Africa, man's ancient quest for immortality gets another boost. Philip Bleiberg, a Cape Town dentist, is kept alive by a heart from a black garment worker. In the next 2 years, more than 150 patients will receive other people's hearts. Most of them will die soon after. Bleiberg's surgeon, Dr. Christian Barnard, becomes an instant celebrity as medicine slowly merges with showbiz.
I was pleasantly surprised by the results that we've achieved and the number of transplants that have been done and by how well we've been able to manage these patients in the post-operative period. I must say I thought that our initial mortality was going to be much higher, that the patients will not survive as well and as long as they have.
But where are the hearts going to come from? Spare part surgery raises some tricky ethical questions. Malcolm Muggeridge voices his objections.
There are, of course, a number of obvious points. Since a heart to be transplanted must be alive, it's obviously very difficult to be assured that the donor is indubitably dead. Then there's the question of priorities. It must seem shocking that there should be such a vast display of medical facilities to protract the life of a middle-aged dentist in a continent where millions and millions of fellow human beings lack the most elementary medicaments and medical services. Then again, there's the strong possibility, if not certainty, that as this operation is perfected, a demand will be set up to use lunatics and other socially useless people, ostensibly so, as donors.
He used to be Larry Love, then Derry Dover. Now he's Tiny Tim, and God bless us everyone. Confrontation, nothing is sacred, not even the White House. Mrs. Johnson hosts a luncheon for ladies, among them singer Eartha Kitt. Miss Kitt breaks up the chit-chat with an impassioned attack on the administration. The reason for crime in the streets, she tells them, is the war in Vietnam. Criticized for rudeness to the First Lady, Miss Kitt defends herself.
The people whom I have heard from, their opinion is that what I said was right. They are in back of me 100%. A great many of Americans have told me through their telegrams and letters and phone calls that if they had the chance, they would have done the same thing.
other well-known citizens are more critical. Benjamin Spock, whose book on baby care civilized the rearing habits of the American home, becomes a hero of the generation he helped to foster. He advises young men to refuse induction into the army. Some of them burn their draft cards in front of him. Dr. Spock calls it symbolic free speech.
I'd say to those who criticize us for the militancy of our dissent that if they are serious about law and order, they should first provide it for the Vietnamese people, for our own black people, and for our own poor people.
The FBI calls his advice a crime. The 66-year-old Spock is indicted in Boston on charges of conspiring to break the Selective Service Law. In New York, another Spock product is in trouble. Linda LeClaire of Barnard College is threatened with expulsion for living with her boyfriend.
Well, I'm very unhappy that Barnard has to go through that kind of thing. I think that part of the problem, though, was that the college always maintained an image of nothing like this ever happening, and all of the students being very much isolated and very much concerned with studies and not much else. And I think that if the college had always been open about the way its students lived, and if students had always been allowed to be open about the way they lived, then there wouldn't be this big smash all of a sudden.
Richard Nixon's daughter takes the more traditional route. Julie pledges her troth to Dwight David Eisenhower II and makes it a big day for the Republicans. Weddings are in the air everywhere, even in the Ionian Sea, where Jacqueline Kennedy's new home is a floating palace called Christina. The former First Lady marries shipping tycoon Aristotle Onassis on the island of Scorpius. The USS Pueblo, an electronic spy ship, is seized by North Korea with all her snooping devices intact. The communists claim the Pueblo and her 83-man crew have invaded North Korea's territorial waters. Washington says the spy ship was hijacked just outside the 12-mile limit. Most people's sympathy goes to Commander Lloyd Bucher and his crew, clapped in a North Korean jail and mistreated, sometimes tortured, for what the communists call their criminal acts. North Korea releases pictures of Bucher writing a confession. The State Department says the confession is a fake. It reads, in part, "I have no excuse whatsoever for my criminal act." It is almost a year before Bucher and his men are released. The Pueblo itself remains behind to become the biggest ship in the North Korean Navy. For Mrs. Rose Bucher and the anxious relatives of the Pueblo men, it's been an interminable wait, and now a welcome homecoming. But the loss of the Pueblo raises grave questions about surveillance ships close to enemy shores. At Columbia University, legitimate grievances erupt into violence as students barricade themselves into university buildings. Their leader is a 20-year-old ex-Boy Scout, Mark Rudd.
Okay, people, keep cool. They're cops, Marine, this crowd here. None of us will begin any violence.
The student demands no more secret military research, no more construction on land in Harlem, no punishment for occupying the buildings. President Grayson Kirk makes what he calls a painful decision and invites in the police.
Gentlemen, show them the sidewalk on the building.
The decision proves painful for everyone as New York's finest restore law and order.
That's what the cops did.
When we found out that Grayson Kirk had called to have cops come in We stood in front of Low Library with our arms locked, faculty and students singing, "We shall overcome, we shall not be moved, no violence."
Well, I saw one policeman chasing a rather plump girl who really couldn't even run and who was doing nothing but running away from him. He dodged her the way you tease a bull before you kill it. And when she gave up, he went and smashed her over the head with a club.
6 days of occupation have taken their toll on the furniture.
Well, this is vandalism of the most inexcusable order. This is a library, supposed to be, or was.
Students claim the police are responsible for some of the damage. Faculty and students turn against the administration, and a strike closes Columbia down. The speech-making continues.
Now, there are rumors that the university taking people over to mathematics and showing them all that vandalism that was done there. All that property that was destroyed. All that property that was destroyed. They got a thing about property, this administration. They're really hung up about it.
And when we were taken out of mathematics, we started shouting a phrase. And it's a phrase that's been used in other words and by actions of people all around the world when they face troops. And that phrase is, "Up against the wall, mother..."
It is May in Paris, where 10 years of autocratic rule is beginning to tell.
The problem is that the whole French society is corrupted, is rotten. Cinema, paintings, theaters, the intellectual artists or workers or students cannot do what they want because they hurt themselves to the structures, the political and cultural structures. We cannot do anything.
As students occupy the Sorbonne and march through the Latin Quarter, the police attack. Public sympathy goes to the students at the barricades. Almost every university in France closes down. The revolt spreads to the workers. 800,000 turn out in the streets. Within a week, 9 million are on strike, and the Fifth Republic is on its knees. Elections are called. President de Gaulle and Premier Pompidou plead for support from the French people against what Pompidou calls totalitarian communist doctrine. At the same time, the general promises university reform, pay raises for the workers, and law and order in the streets. He wins the election with a massive majority. In Prague, too, students and workers are out in the streets. The monolithic unity of the socialist bloc crumbles as Soviet tanks roll toward Wenceslas Square. 23 years ago, the Red Army was welcomed as the liberators of Czechoslovakia. Now they are booed and jeered and spat upon. The Czech Army offers no resistance. "We yield to a superior power," says the Central Committee of the Communist Party. Reformers Dubček and Svoboda are hustled off to Moscow. The arrival of the Russians in Prague puts an end to the changes promised by Party Secretary Alexander Dubček. Under the slogan, "Socialism with a Human Face," the popular Dubček had begun to reform the country's economic life and its bureaucratic government structure. By the end of the year, he will be dismissed from all party posts. Press and television censorship is reintroduced, and thousands of Czechs flee the country to start a new life abroad. The Olympic Stadium, Mexico City. Outside, the government crushes the bloodiest student revolt of 1968. Inside, 6,000 peace doves are provided for the opening ceremony. Tommy Smith and teammate John Carlos climb onto the winner's stand and to the strains of the Star-Spangled Banner, salute Black Power. They're thrown off the team for what the Olympic Committee calls immature conduct, but they regroup back home. At a Black Power conference, they're given some further awards by Stokely Carmichael.
It's my wife and I. That's for you. That's for Tommy. And this is for Brother Harry Edwards, who started it.
John Carlos explains the point of view of a new generation of black athletes.
I'm not the type of man my father was. My father sat back and took a lot of stuff, and I don't intend to take it.
And Brother Tommy Smith, Brother John Carlos, and Brother Harry Edwards joins the rank of Brother Muhammad Ali, because we want black people who are concerned with us first and with sports second. Yeah!
Unlike track and field, golf remains untroubled by the politics of race. At the U.S. Open, Lee Trevino wins his first big tournament. But the gallery favorites are still Arnold Palmer and Jack Nicklaus. Big League Baseball goes international. The Montreal Expos are the National League's newest expansion team. In the season opener, the St. Louis Cardinals pace the ball all over the stadium. A grand slam home run does it to the Expos, but their fans aren't giving up yet. In the World Series, it's the Cardinals again, but this time they face stiffer opposition. 1968 is the year of the pitcher, and Denny McClain of the Detroit Tigers has won 31 games in the regular season. The Tigers come from behind to win in the seventh and final game. Auto racing is one of the decade's most popular sports. But as more fans watch faster cars on more grueling tracks, lovers of the king of sport are saddened by news of the death of the best driver of them all, Jimmy Clark. But the race must go on. April is the cruelest month, wrote the poet. April brings Martin Luther King to Memphis for the last time. The Lorraine Motel is a cheap cinder block rooming house. King is gunned down as he stands on the balcony taking the fresh air. Days before, he delivered a prophetic final testament.
Like anybody, I would like to live a long life. Longevity has its place. But I'm not concerned about that now. I just want to do God's will. And he's allowed me to go up to the mountain. And I've looked over. And I've seen the promised land. I may not get there with you, but I want you to know tonight that we as a people will get to the promised land. So I'm happy tonight. I'm not worried about anything. I'm not fearing any man. Mine eyes have seen the glory of the coming.
In Atlanta, it is Palm Sunday, and the mourners come to pay their last respects to the man who spoke for peace in a time of strife. In the wake of King's death, looting and arson scourge the nation's cities. One of those who had come to believe in King's cause was Robert Kennedy.
Martin Luther King dedicated his life to love and to justice between fellow human beings. He died in the cause of that effort. In this difficult day, in this difficult time for the United States, it's perhaps well to ask what kind of a nation we are and what direction we want to move in. For those of you who are black and are tempted to be filled with hatred and distrust of the injustice of such an act against all white people, I would only say that I can also feel in my own heart the same kind of feeling. I had a member of my family killed, but he was killed by a white man. But we have to make an effort in the United States. We have to make an effort to understand, to get beyond or go beyond these rather difficult times. What we need in the United States is not division. What we need in the United States is not hatred. What we need in the United States is not violence and lawlessness, but is love and wisdom and compassion toward one another.
Martin Luther King believed that to maintain her moral leadership, the United States must do two things: grant equality to Negroes and end the war in Vietnam. For the Vietnamese, it is the 25th year of almost continuous warfare. For the United States, it is year five.
Let's go. Move that second squad on through.
Make sure there's nobody in it first.
Make sure you get it, brother, sir.
Make sure nobody in it.
Get somebody in that box.
There are now 500,000 U.S. troops in Indochina. Against them, an uncertain number of Viet Cong and North Vietnamese regulars. But who are the Viet Cong and who are the civilians? If you're a Marine, it's not easy to tell, even when you're fired upon.
Probably up on the other side of this open area.
In the north, the U.S. air offensive batters the cities for the 36th month. In the south, search and destroy missions lay waste the countryside. Refugees flock to the cities, fleeing the sound of the guns. The lunar celebrations of Tet mark the year of the monkey, the most ominous in the Chinese calendar. On the morning of January 31st, North Vietnamese General Giap strikes. 200 population centers are attacked simultaneously. In Saigon itself, Viet Cong penetrate the heart of the city and invade the U.S. embassy. Claim victory in the Tet Offensive. The Viet Cong are forced to retreat with heavy casualties. But 1,100 American soldiers lie dead, and the cities of South Vietnam are no longer secure.
The folks here, some of them are sympathizers with the VC. Consequently, they run supply for them. They feed them. They clothe them. They hide them. And that's the problem we run into here. And the field... You find some good down-to-earth people who have good principles, and they won't tolerate Charlie, and consequently he has no hiding place unless he digs a hole in the ground.
General Westmoreland asks for another 200,000 troops. Congress is reluctant to send them. This year alone, the war will cost the taxpayer $30 billion. Across the country, the Tet Offensive causes many to question President Johnson's handling of the war. On national television, the president replies to his critics.
The biggest fact is that the stated purposes of the general uprising, a military victory or a psychological victory, have failed. The communist leaders, according to their plans, had counted on great popular support in the cities for this uprising effort. They found little or none.
The war is expensive. It is also dirty on both sides, fought with terror, napalm, and fragmentation bombs. Pictures of the maimed and wounded appear each evening on the newscasts in living rooms across the country. Modern communications, not the Viet Cong, bring the war home to America.
And having judged that the war in Vietnam was a mistake without precedent in our history, we're called upon... We cannot stop with that judgment, but we're called upon to search out the causes and the conditions that led us into it. And this may require us to make the hardest and the harshest judgments about our national assumptions, about the institutions that embody them, and about some of the leaders who have become the spokesmen for this cause.
The pundits say he hasn't a hope, but Minnesota Senator Eugene McCarthy defies his own party and runs in the primaries on an anti-war platform. In New Hampshire, he picks up 42% of the vote. In Massachusetts, he captures the delegation. One name is absent from the list of presidential candidates, Lyndon B. Johnson.
I shall not seek, and I will not accept, the nomination of my party for another term as your president.
With Johnson out of the race, the Democrats are hopelessly split. The president's farewell speech stuns the nation and clears the way for Robert Kennedy.
But I thought it was going well, my campaign, especially when I was out in California and I received a telephone call from George Hamilton.
His reference to Linda Byrd's boyfriend shows Bobby has the White House constantly in mind.
He asked for my daughter's telephone number.
His major theme, however, is to close the gap between rich and poor, young and old.
We cannot tolerate lawlessness, and we cannot tolerate violence. But the fact is that some of our fellow citizens have turned against our society and turned against our government. People perhaps that you do not see, people that perhaps you do not come in contact with. But they feel that their children can't get a decent education. They see their children 1 year behind and losing 1 year by the time they get to the third grade, 2 years behind the sixth grade, losing 10 points on their IQ between the fifth and the eighth grade in the ghetto schools of the United States. 17,000 people bitten by rats every year. What would you do? In the fact you can't get a job, only 40% of the men that live in the ghetto have jobs that pay more than $60 a week. How can you support a family? How can you bring up children in dignity? 43% of the housing run down and dilapidated. How can you raise a family under those kind of conditions? The fact is that this still exists in the United States of America.
Started late, in 11 weeks of campaigning, Kennedy draws huge crowds.
Well,
Now the California results put the nomination within his grasp. At midnight, he addresses his campaign workers and supporters in a hotel in downtown Los Angeles.
I want to express my gratitude to my dog Freckles, who's been maligned. I don't care what they... As Franklin Roosevelt said, I don't care what they say about me, but when they start to attack my dog... I'm not doing this in the order of importance, but I also want to thank my wife, Ethel.
My thanks to all of you, and now it's on to Chicago, and let's win there.
Brother need not be idealized or enlarged in death beyond what he was in life. To be remembered simply as a good and decent man who saw wrong and tried to right it, saw suffering and tried to heal it, saw war and tried to stop it. Those of us who loved him and who take him to his rest today pray that what he was to us, and what he wished for others, will someday come to pass for all the world. As he said many times in many parts of this nation, to those he touched and who sought to touch him, some men see things as they are and say, why? I dream things that never were and say, why not?
August in Chicago is stifling. The city hosts the Democratic National Convention despite bus, taxi, and telephone strikes. For Mayor Richard Daley, it's his 13th year in office, and Chicago's a wonderful town.
Chicago, always an exciting city, is this week the most exciting city in the nation. Here history is being made, or the decisions reached at the Democratic National Convention will influence the course of national and world events. It is only fitting that during this dynamic democratic processes, there is present in our city a cross-section, a representation of the voices of America, liberal, moderate, conservative, and radical, young and old, hawk and dove, hippie and square, people of every color, creed and national origin, from every state and territory in the Union. This is the sound of liberty, and this is the way it should be, because this is America. Let us all be proud of this magnificent expression of free speech and assembly, founded on the fundamental principle that each one of us respects the rights of the other.
You call a cop a sissy, you call him a fag, you call him a commie Jew bastard, he gets insulted. You call him a pig or a Nazi stormtrooper, he digs that, because that's his concept of manliness. But you don't call him a pig, no. A pig's a nice person, man. He's our candidate.
The Yippies arrive in force, led by Abby Hoffman. In the park, the anti-war demonstrators practice Japanese riot tactics. They want permission to sleep in the park. Mayor Daley says no. 5,000 National Guardsmen and 7,000 federal troops are sent to beef up the Chicago police force. Unequal contest. Nightsticks and tear gas turn the streets into a battlefield.
Go ahead, come on, do it, officer.
Screams of battle are carried by transistor radio into the convention hall, where an older America is about to elect a candidate.
My fellow Americans, my fellow Democrats, I proudly accept the nomination of our party. And may we just share for a moment a few of those immortal words of the prayer of St. Francis of Assisi. Words which I think may help heal the wounds, ease the pain, and lift our hearts. Listen to this immortal saint. Where there is hatred, let me sow love. Where there is injury, pardon. Where there is doubt, faith. Where there is despair, hope. Where there is darkness, light. And may America tonight resolve that never, never again shall we see what we have seen.
The Republican Party plays it down the middle. Richard Nixon, who 6 years ago said he was finished with politics, returns to lead the campaign. The new fashion Nixon runs an old-fashioned campaign. And that's what the country seems to want.
Shut up.
Hubert Humphrey appeals for what he calls the politics of joy. The polls show that the vice president is the underdog. So, he tries harder.
Tell you that this is a terrible time to be alive, a war abroad and no peace at home. I'm going to tell you my view. Sure, we've got problems. But my friends, whenever you think of the United States of America, remember, this is still the place travel any other country abroad. The traffic's all one way. They're coming this way. They're not going over there to live.
All he has said that he has taken a stand on 167 issues. And I checked it out. And I want to tell you that that stand, that firm stand that he's taken on 167 issues makes a bowl of jello look like concrete.
A new voice is being heard in America today. It's a voice that has been silent too long. It is a voice of people who haven't taken to the streets before, who haven't indulged in violence, who haven't broken the law. They're good citizens. They're decent people. They're not racist. They know that this country isn't going to be a good place for us to live in if it isn't a good place for all of us to live in. And so under these circumstances, these people are what I call the forgotten Americans. And the forgotten Americans are beginning to speak out, and they're going to speak with a resounding voice on November the 5th to get the new leadership that America needs.
But ladies and gentlemen, they're not going to do it. We're going to succeed. We're going to win.
But I'll tell you, it isn't going to be like 48. Lots of things have changed. You remember that was the year that Harry Truman won by giving him hell. Well, it won't work this time. Because just remember, I'm sure you will all agree with this, that it's one thing to give him hell, but it's something else to give him Humphrey, believe me.
Richard Nixon, President-elect.
I, as you probably have heard, have received a very gracious message from the Vice President congratulating me for winning the election. I saw many signs in this campaign. Some of them were not friendly. Some were very friendly. But the one that touched me the most was one that I saw in Dexter, Ohio, at the end of a long day of whistle-stopping. A little town, I suppose five times the population was there in the dusk. It was almost impossible to see, but a teenager held up a sign, "Bring us together." And that will be the great objective of this administration at the outset, to bring the American people together. This will be an open administration. Open to new ideas, open to men and women of both parties, open to the critics as well as those who support us. We want to bridge the generation gap. We want to bridge the gap between the races. We want to bring America together.
Americans want a change, says Nixon. In 1968, not too many people would quarrel with that.